Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Throughout the scriptures, we see that God is able to provide. Does not matter what the need might be, God is able to give in order to bring about completion. And God loves to provide. But are we wise enough in order to seek His provision and accept it from whatever source that it comes from? See, many people are not, because they have prejudice, they may be racist, they may have pride in certain areas, and they will not humble themselves to realize that many of the ways that God brings His provision is a way that brings about individuals to stop trusting in self and start depending upon Him. And this is certainly a true statement in regard to what we're going to see today in our study. Take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Daniel in chapter 5. The book of Daniel in chapter 5. Now, we saw last week where there was a group of men and women under the leader of the king of Babylon, Belshazzar, and they were praising the gods of gold and silver and bronze and iron and wood and stone, instead of giving honor and worship to the God of Israel. We saw how there was a manifestation from heaven, how there was a hand that appeared and wrote upon that wall. And they were all amazed, and Belshazzar, he was extremely moved by this event. And they called the wizards and the Chaldeans and the magicians and the wise people of this Babylonian empire. And once again, as so often is the case, they were unable to discern what this all meant. They couldn't understand the writing, and they could not give an interpretation of it. So as a last resort, but what we talked about was the fact that the queen came in. And we learn a very important biblical truth, that wives are given in order to be a helpmate, in order that the man can complete God's call in his life. And it's wonderful to see a man and woman coming together in a covenant of marriage, being used both for the glory of God. So this queen comes forward. She says, you don't need to be upset about the fact that these wise men of Babylon could not answer your requests. For there is a man. He has a most excellent spirit, a spirit of a holy God. His name is Daniel. He's from the exiles of Judah, and he will be able to read it and interpret it. Well, this king Belshazzar, he heard this, and Daniel was brought in before him. And let's pick up our study in verse 16 and see what took place. Daniel chapter 5 and verse 16. The king is speaking and he says, I have heard that you are able to clarify interpretations and to release those things that have been closed up. And now, if you are able to read the inscription and to make known its interpretation, you will be dressed with this royal purple garment, and a golden chain will be placed around your neck, and you will rule as number three in my kingdom. So this is what Daniel's being offered: a position of prominence and also a garment of prestige, one that reflects a uniqueness within this kingdom. And notice Daniel's response. I mean, he says this with a degree of brashness and an uninterest for the things of this world. Look to the next verse, verse 17. And Daniel then answered and he said before the king, "Your presents keep for yourself, your gifts give to another. But the inscription I will read for the king, and its interpretation I will tell him." So Daniel, he's going to do what he's asked to do, but he wants nothing from it. Why? Well, here's a principle. Daniel is not so concerned in what he can get from this world. Daniel knows that to be one of great prestige and honor in the kingdoms of men has no lasting significance. He doesn't want that royal garment. He doesn't want that expensive chain around his neck. And he's not really concerned with having some position of authority under a pagan king. So he says, you know, these rewards you keep for yourselves or you give to another, but I will make known. And what Daniel knows is this. He knows that this inscription is from God. He knows it's revelation. So Daniel, being a faithful servant of God, he wants to make known the revelation of God. And that's why he says, verse 18, "King, the kingdom and the greatness and the honor and the glory is given by the Most High God. And it was given to Nebuchadnezzar, your father." He wants him to know, you're in this position because your father was placed there by God. Not the gods of gold and silver and bronze and iron and wood and stone, but the God of Israel. Verse 19. "And because of greatness that was given to him, they shook and they feared from him all the people." So he was so exalted that all the people acknowledged his greatness. Verse 19 in the second half. "And he was able to, whom he wanted to, he was able to put to death, and whom he wanted to, he was able to keep alive. And whom he wanted to exalt, he could exalt, and who he wanted to make low, he could make low." So it's saying here that he had all of this authority, all of this power. And this is very important. But what did he do with that power? What did he do with God's provision in his life? That's the question. Verse 20. "But when his heart was exalted and his spirit was mighty for evil," he used this honor, this provision, and he used it not for the purposes of God. Your Bible will say for evil, meaning against God, against the things of God. "And he was brought down from the throne of his kingdom, and his glory was removed from him." And this all goes back to what happened. Now remember the context. We began chapter 5 last week, and we saw something. We saw that it began immediately after Nebuchadnezzar, that he made this statement about how God brings down the prideful ones. And Belshazzar, his son, hasn't learned that message. And here's the difference. People will say, well, you know, this isn't fair. Because Nebuchadnezzar was given a second chance. Let me tell you, second chances or third chances are not a requirement. They are an outcome of God's graciousness. And God does not have to be gracious in the same way to all the people. He has to be just. And what we find here is that Nebuchadnezzar, he was a recipient of that. But the intent was that people would learn from him, meaning what God did in his life, through his life, this judgment and the restoration that would follow. This man, Belshazzar, he saw all of that. He was a recipient of that same revelation, but he is rebelling against it. And that's what Daniel wants to remind him. So he says, you know, you'll remember that your father, when his heart was exalted and powerful was his spirit to do evil, that he was taken off the throne, that he was removed from the throne, and his honor was removed from him. verse 21. And he was cast forth from humanity. And his heart was likened to that of a heart of a beast. And with the wild donkeys was his dwelling place. Grass they fed to him as an ox, and from the dew of the heavens, and from the rain he was made wet. Until what? Until he recognized that the Most High God, he rules in the kingdom of men. And to whom he wants, he establishes it upon it. So God is sovereign. Now this is probably the third, fourth, fifth time that this truth has been set forth in our studies from chapter 4 and chapter 5. And the implication of the text is this man Belshazzar, he was there for it all. He would have witnessed this, but he did not respond to the testimony of God. And we need to ask ourselves, am I doing that? Am I responding to the testimony of God? Am I someone who learns something God teaches me and I learn it and I integrate it into my life, or do I forget it and go right back to that other way of living? That's what we need to be asking ourselves. And if we're not answering it affirmatively, that we're doing those things, putting it into practice, learning from God's revelation, you can expect what this passage is going to. Why do I say that? Well, look if you would to verse 22. And you, Belshazzar, his son, you have not humbled your heart, but rather, even though that you have known all of this. So it's just what we've talked about. He witnessed this, he knew all of this, but it made no difference in his life. It did not bring him to humanity. Verse 23. But you have exalted yourselves over the Lord of heaven. Here again, a change. Goes back from initially to king. Well, initially it says the God of heavens. Then it goes to the King of heaven, speaking of authority, and now even a stronger word, Lord or Master of heavens. What have you done? Well, you've exalted yourself because the vessels of his house, the house of God, the temple, has been brought before you. You and your officials, your wives and your concubines, you have drank from them wine, and you have given praise to the gods of silver and gold and bronze and iron and wood and stone that are not able to see, not able to hear, not able to know that you are even praising them. And the God who your breath is in his hand, and all of your ways, you have not honored, you have not given glory. Now, this is such a wise statement. People, they worship, they give to, they allow influence from those things that have no true lasting authority whatsoever. Many times, these things are just false impressions. People are following a false god, Allah, following false writings in the Quran and many other different religions. And they bow down, they worship, and they do things that have no truth attached to them whatsoever. It is time to change. It is time to repent. You know, for some reason, we get many emails from Muslims. And one such email asked me a question. And he says, do you love Muslims? And I wrote back and said, yes, I do. We are commanded to love all people and be willing to lay down our life for others. You know, a good man, well, he might lay down his life for a friend, but one that's under God's authority would lay down his life for all people in order that that person might live a little bit longer and that he might come to faith in Messiah. So we're not against individuals, we're just against individuals embracing false teachings. And what we have here is this statement from Daniel telling, you have worshiped incorrectly. You've gone after idols that are able to do nothing, and you're not praising the one whose breath is in your hand. Verse 24. Then what happened was a portion of a hand was sent before you and inscribed upon, inscribed this inscription, verse 25. And this is what's written as is inscribed. Mane, mane, tekel, ufrasim. So Daniel, in order to show he knew exactly what it meant, he was able to enunciate those letters, which the other enchanters, magicians, wizards, Chaldeans, and wise men of Babylon were not able to do. So Daniel says, this is what this inscription that was written by this hand that appeared. It is, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Ufrasim. Now, he just wasn't able to read it, meaning he understood the language, but keep reading verse 26. He was going to give its interpretation. This is the interpretation of the manner. Mene, he says, God has, and this is related to Aramaic and Hebrew. We find the word Mene. Well, it is from the Hebrew word mana, which is to appoint. So God appointed the days of your kingdom, and he has found them to be coming to an end. They are completed. They are ending. Then the word tekel. He has weighed. You have been weighed in the balances, and you have been found to be lacking. So your kingdom's coming to an end, and you are lacking before me. And then the word here, peres, which is, it will be taken from you and given to the Medes and the Persians. So what God is saying here is something very important. And that is, there's a change coming. Now let's stop for a moment. We could go back and think about Nebuchadnezzar, his father. There was a change coming in his life as well. Remember those 7 years when he was cast away? But this is different. There was a prophecy concerning Nebuchadnezzar that his kingdom was going to be restored to him after 7 years. But here we find, look carefully at the text. It says here that his kingdom is not going to be restored to him, but it's going to be given to another. It says in the verse 28, it's going to be given to the Medes and the Persians. There's going to be a new empire that takes over. Verse 29. Then Belshazzar, after he heard this, he commanded that Daniel be dressed in argamon, that royal purple, and that a golden chain be placed around his neck, and that he be proclaimed that he is the ruler, number three ruler in the kingdom. So what do we have here? Well, we have a result. We have this man Belshazzar honoring his word. He knew, and this is the key, he knew within himself what Daniel had taught him, revealed to him about this writing. He knew it was true. Why? Because it was factual that he had experienced what went on during his father's life. How Nebuchadnezzar was exalted in such a magnificent way, that his kingdom was so expansive, it was so prosperous and wealthy, and how in a moment it was taken from him. And then how in another moment it was restored back to him. And he remembered his father when his father publicly said before all of his kingdom, that there is one God, the Most High God, and he exalts whom he wants, and he brings down whom he wants. And how a wise response to this God is to praise him, to honor him, to glorify him, to serve him, whose ways are truth and whose actions are righteous. Now, Belshazzar, he knew this, but he wasn't displaying it. So let me ask a question. Once again, not a new question for us, but one that I've asked repeatedly. And that is, what God has revealed to you, are you faithfully carrying it out? If you do, you will find change beginning in your life. You will find spiritual maturity. But if you are not wise and you reject the revelation of God, you know what's going to happen? You're going to find that God will, this principle has been already set up in the world. When we rebel against revelation, it causes our heart to be hardened. It makes it dull to the revelation of God. And therefore, the next time something comes up, it's going to be more difficult for us to respond. It puts us on a downward motion rather than being lifted up. And why do I say it in this way? Because Paul tells us that the call of Messiah is an upward call. But when we reject, we go down. It is going to bring about an end. Up has to do with future. Up has to do with a kingdom experience. Down has to do with judgment, a coming to an end. And this is going to be borne out in the text because no sooner did we find Daniel being given that purple garment and Daniel being put into the third position with that golden chain around his neck. Notice what happens. Look, if you would, to verse 30. That same night, Belshazzar, he was killed, the king of the Chaldeans. And what's important is there was an ending of that empire. And that's why I want to emphasize so important this end of opportunity. When you rebel against the things that God has made known to you, it will bring about an end, ultimately a final end for you. Belshazzar, he found it out the hard way. Well, let's look at one more verse. Look at the last verse of chapter 5 in the English. It's actually the first verse of chapter 6 in the Hebrew, but we're going to read it together now. A new king emerges, a new empire. It says, and Darius, now many of you say Darius, but literally it's Darius the Mede, was about 62 years old when he became to reign. And think about that. That is an old age for someone beginning to be king. And what is that speaking about? It's speaking about someone who had maturity. Someone who had learned, experienced many things in his life, and now he was going to be placed in this situation of leadership. And what's so important to realize is this, that there's a new empire, and all of those of the Chaldeans, and notice what the scripture says here. That night, Belshazzar, he was killed, the king of the Chaldeans. Now, the Chaldeans is another word for Babylon. It's synonymous. It's a synonym. So we're having an end to that and a new beginning of the Medes and what we'll find the Persians thereafter. And why is this so important? Well, it's important because there is going to be a vastly different character under this empire. Now, the Medes and the Persians, for example, we have a king Ahasuerus in the book of Esther, and we see other times that they did persecute the Jewish people. But here's the key. There were times within the Medes and the Persians where things went very well. For example, we'll talk later on about Koresh, that is Cyrus, and how he was used by God to bring the people back from exile to the land of Judah. And what the scripture is saying is there is a transition happening for the people of Judah in exile. And the thing that stands out is this. The Chaldeans, they've come to the end. The Babylonians are no more. But you know who is? Daniel. Daniel makes it through this transition. And what's so important is Daniel, he becomes a person of great influence in this new empire. Now, we don't see that with anyone else. We don't see a transfer of the leaders, of the noblemen, of those satraps, and those individuals that had a position of authority, the wise men of Babylon, coming into this new empire. No, they're done away with. But Daniel, he makes it through. And what does it show? God's sovereignty. God's in control. God is using Daniel. Why? Well, what are we told about Daniel? He is from the exiles of Judah. That is, Daniel is part of the people that God has put his hand upon for the purpose of bringing blessing. So God, this is what a lot of people forget. God, he had Daniel there for the Babylonians to bless them with revelation. They ultimately rejected it. Secondly, God had Daniel there to bless the Medes and the Persians. Why? God is using Israel for that. And that's why we see what's taking place in this world. We see a rise of anti-Semitism. We see an anti-Israelism growing in a very public way among many political leaders of cities and of independent nations. And among the groups such as the United Nations and European Union. And why is that? Well, God, he is moving to bring about a conclusion. He is going to bring about a conclusion of this world in order to establish his kingdom. And what's the key to that? Israel. Now, people don't believe that, so many even within the church, but it is a factual statement. God is going to use Israel in a mighty way in the last days. And in doing so, more Gentiles will come to faith, and then the kingdom will be established. And because this world is in darkness, what does the scripture point out? Belshazzar, he was killed at nighttime. Why? Nighttime, choshek, darkness. He was absent of the revelation of God. And when you're absent of God's revelation, what's going to happen? You are going to be against what God's, his provision, what he wants to provide you for a blessing. See, the people don't want the kingdom of God. They like darkness. They like this world. They don't want the righteous changes that God's going to bring about in this world. So the question is, where are we going to come in regard to this transition? Are we going to be found faithful, or are we going to reject and reject and reject revelation and find ourselves being cut off like Belshazzar? He knew the truth. He just wouldn't respond to it in an obedient manner. Here again, you have to make that same decision each and every day. Well, I'll close with that. Until next week.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.